students, dear students, NAHEP team and all. I welcome you all on my own behalf and on the behalf of IDP as well as College of Fisheries team. I welcome you everyone today on this lecture series what we are starting today with the help of IDP NAHEP. I welcome you all. In this first, I request our dean, Dr. Rajesh Chauhan sir, to say few words about Dr. Lab. Sir.
I think
sir, Kashyap sir, आप जल्दी भी होंगे पहले सर आपका IDP का तो आपसे सर दो स्टेप तो सुन ले.
Thank you, Dr. Vipul.
Yes, sir, yeah. sir. I request you to say something about IDP and NAHEP.
Of course.
Sir. Yes, sir.
Welcoming all the guests today on this platform, especially speaker of the day, very eminent personality, Professor S.N. Lal Saab, Dr. Chauhan, Dean Fisheries, all the illustrious faculty members of College of Fisheries Sciences, all the students and other experts, scientists, professionals who have joined today to listen to the experts, illustrious experts of the day. University gained this opportunity of undertaking this IDP NAHEP project, World Bank funded project, with this very specific objective that university is already doing great lot things in context of teaching, research and extension. But it is to cement those educational transformation related aspects as today we are experiencing that we have an international community into the university periphery, where our students and our faculty members would be having a chance to listen to an international faculty. So similar many other avenues, networking, alignments, innovation, creating ecosystems for networking and converging, and thinking beyond what is happening into the classrooms, thinking of higher order cognitive domains of the students, bringing artificial intelligence into agriculture, robotics into agriculture, data mining context into agricultural context. These are the focus areas of IDP NAHEP. So IDP NAHEP into this university has been working for more than about 18 months now, and we have been toiling, making utmost efforts to create infrastructure plus ecosystem related to educational transformation, and we are on the path. Today, it's splendid to see a very illustrious, stalwart faculty, though the person who would be speaking today. We are here to listen to his perspectives and gain insights, because being into our own ivory towers that we are doing great, of course, we make our efforts, but we have to keep our windows open to get insights from the experts and stalwarts from all across, to think that convergence is the mantra of the time. So with this spirit, we are here. I again put heartfelt thanks for the expert who has spared his valuable time to be on the platform today. Dr. R.S. Chauhan Saab, who took utmost pains, and he has created the platform, and we are there along today on this on auspicious occasion, and all those who have joined, many many thanks. And I just put the onus towards listening to the stalwart of the day. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much sir. Thanks a lot. So really, sir is working very hard day and night. Whenever we are seeing, he is busy always in to come up with the new things in IDP NAHEP, which is a prestigious project what we got it for the university. So in continuation, I request our dean, Dr. R. S. Chauhan sir, to say a few words about the lab, sir. Sir, please.
Thank you, Dr. Vipul. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Professor Kashyap, PI, IDP, NAHEP, and Dean College of Agriculture. My Professor Lab, a renowned personality in his own field. And Dr. Langer, my old friend and retired faculty from CIFE Mumbai. And Professor Upadhyay, our former dean of our college, my faculty members, and students, and the staff from IDP NAHIP involved in this venture. This lecture series, it is planned on the initiation of Dr. Kashyap, that we should call some outside stalwarts outside India in the to deliver lectures for the benefit of particularly our students, and then add others also, other stakeholders in the sector, in fisheries and aquaculture sector. Those may be benefited from the great experience of the stalwarts in their own field. So today we are initiating this lecture series. Today will be the first lecture of this series from Professor S.N. Lab, and we have chosen our speakers from Thailand. He is from Nepal. Then from Thailand, Dr. Salin from Asian Institute of Technology will come. Then other speaker will be from France, then China, then USA, and so on. In they will deliver the lectures in various cutting edge technologies and the innovative technologies in the field of fisheries and aquaculture. Coming to today's speaker, Professor Syam Narayan Lab is a renowned fisheries scientist. He had been a professor in Tribhuvan University, Nepal, and visited many countries outside Nepal. He had been a Fulbright scholar in University of Idaho, USA, and he is now head campus research committee, Amrit Campus, Tribhuvan University, and he founded the Nepal Aquaculture Society, and he is also, in addition to his research work, he is also involved in many works, social works related to the livelihood earning of the society. So with these words, I welcome Professor Lab to please start his today's lecture. Professor Lab, please.
Thank you, sir. I feel pleasure to be here, and I am very much obliged to all these organizing committee, and especially Professor R.S. Chauhan, who gave me the opportunity to just share my idea in this special gathering. So without going to the another formality, I would like to share my slide and go to the directly in my speech. So is there, the slide is shared?
Not yet, sir. Not yet, sir. Please share it again. Yes, sir.
Is it visible?
Yes, sir.
My sound is coming there. Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Audible, clear sound is there. Thank you, sir.
Okay, so our today's sharing is about the rainbow trout culture in the Himalayan kingdom. And we will complete all these today's discussion, today's sharing under this following heading. There will be the background introduction, aquaculture in Nepal, aquaculture education system in Nepal, rainbow trout at a glance, rainbow trout introduction, how it came in Nepal, that is historical part, culture and cultivation of rainbow trout in the country, basic information about its life cycle, and the conclusion. So first of all, Nepal is a Himalayan kingdom situated at an altitude varying from 60 meters in the south to 8,848 meters in the north, and is physiographically and agroeconomically very diverse. It is one of the richest countries in the world, possessing about 2.27 of the world water resources. Approximately 5% of the total area of the country is occupied by different freshwater aquatic habitat. Rivers are one of the major sources of captured fisheries, contributing almost 50% of total captured fish production, and a large number of fishermen and their families are involved in captured fisheries, which provide income and partial employment for them. Out of total 8,18,500 hectares of total water surface area, there are about 6,000 rivers and so many rivulets covering 3,95,000 hectares in the country. Some fisheries activities in the lakes, especially around the Pokhara Valley and near the Kathmandu in the Trishuli area, are the main center for the attraction. Nepal lies between India and China. The country touches with India at its southern, western, and eastern border, while the northern border is with China. It in the south, especially, the altitude is just about 50 meters above the sea level, while at being landlocked, now after the Modi, it is land-licked country. The country is deprived of any oceanic resources and overwhelmed by mountains, which comprise about 83% of the total area. The whole country having 147,181 square kilometers. So there are Himalayan region, Middle Hill region, Tarai region, so different elevation, and aquaculture is related, fisheries product is related, production is related in all three different regions. And basically, today our concentration is towards the this rainbow trout. So rainbow trout is the cold water fisheries. So of course, in the Himalayan region, mountain region, the rainbow trout culture is more specific in the country, in Nepal. So altogether, natural waters, these are the rivers are here, rivers, lakes, reservoirs are the estimated area, just 5,000 lakes, 11,396 ponds, and marginal swamps about 9,000, and the paddy fields are, because Nepal is agriculture-based country, so definitely paddy fields are rich. So now, aquaculture is fairly new activity in Nepal, and there are about 12,500 hectares of such area available in the country, of which approximately 1,225 hectares are currently being used for aquaculture. According to recent data in Nepal, around 252 fish species are available, in which 190 are indigenous species and remaining are exotic species. Exotic species are around the 16, endemic are 18, and the species under the culture are carp species are the 7, tilapia 1, catfish 2, and rainbow trout also 1. So altogether there are 29,270 fish ponds in the country. The Tarai Plain alone contains 95% of the total fish production, and the area dedicated to fishery amounts to more than 10,718 hectares, with the total fish production reaching 65,077 tons in the fiscal year. Nepal has aquatic resources, which is located in different altitude and climatic zone. So due to the different freshwater habitat, there is potential for different fisheries and aquaculture activities in Nepal. So these are the some district in the plain area, Tarai area, that is called Bara, Saptari, Chiton, Dhanusa, Rupandehi, Rohtak, Parsa, Sirha, Morang, and Sarlahi. These areas are especially focused for the production of fish in the plain area, in the plain touching the border area, in which Dhanusa and Bara is considered as the super zone of fish production in terms of fisheries by the government of Nepal. In Nepal, as we have just came to know that 252 fish species are available. So there are altogether 15 orders, 40 family, and 120 genera available in the country. Total fish production, aquaculture production, fisheries production, and fish farming in the pond, these contribute 4.18% GDP of the country in the field of agriculture, and per capita fish production is 3.1 kg. Rainbow trout culture is related to the more specific and tried several times and introduced from the different part of the world and even from the India. And nowadays, rainbow trout is native to the rivers which drain into the Pacific Ocean, while brown trout is not available in the country. The commercial culture trout began early in the 1853 in the United States and possibly even earlier in the Europe. It was largely due to the high quality of good taste trout flesh. Various species of trout have been successfully farmed in many countries for hundreds of years and were introduced to the Asian country, including Nepal, during the 19th century. Rainbow trout is now widely distributed in the freshwater of nearly 100 countries worldwide. In Nepal, basically in the mountainous countries, where the 83% of its area is covered by hilly and mountain, is known to possess second largest freshwater resources of the world, and rainbow trout is one of the most suitable fish for commercial farming in the cold climate of the country. The first origin of the rainbow trout is not known when first it is introduced in the Nepal. But in Nepal, two earlier attempts were made to introduce the trout for the sports and the aquaculture development before the 1988. However, on both occasions, the trout could not survive, so it was failed. Rainbow trout was introduced in Nepal from United Kingdom in late 1960 and early 1970 and reintroduced from Japan in 1988. In the third attempt, rainbow trout was introduced in Nepal with 50,000 eyed eggs were brought in from Japan. And since then, rainbow trout has been bred and beared from more than last decades. So trout farming, Nepal exists two fisheries research center. One is in Trishuli and other is in Godavari Research Center. So trout was introduced in Nepal to meet many needs, including substitution of fish imported in hotels, catering for tourists, use of cold water resources for aquaculture, and promotion of fishing tourism in hill stream. The third attempt is the most important attempt of the rainbow trout introduction in the country. Approximately 50,000 eyed eggs were received at the Godavari fish farm in Lalitpur, Kathmandu Valley on 28 December 1988 from the Kobayashi Fisheries Experiment Station, Miyazaki Prefecture, Japan. More than 90% of the eggs survived at that time and were successfully hatched and reared at Godavari when water temperature ranged 8 to 10 degrees Celsius. Hatching was completely after 18 days, successful. Some of the fingerlings were sent to the Fisheries Research Center at Trishuli, which is the second largest center in the country, and the first fish spawned after 2 years. Fry were initially fed with powdered feed obtained from the Japan, but later with locally available chicken yolk powder, buff liver, pellet crumbles, the fish were subject to intensive with the health examination. The Godavari Fisheries Research Center was established in 1962 and is situated in the Kathmandu Valley, which is around 1700 meters above the sea level. The climate is subtropical and very cool, with winter temperature falling 8 degrees in winter and even below 8 degrees, and pond water reach around 26 to 27 in summer, but more than 20 in the stream. The farm is fed by a small stream from surrounding hills. The discharge rate of the stream is approximately 30 liters per second. The Trishuli Fisheries Research Center is some 70 kilometers northeast of the Kathmandu, supplied by the Trishuli River. Water temperature never exceeds above 90 to 20 degrees, making Trishuli suitable for rainbow trout cultivation in the country. The elevation of the farm is approximately 6,000 meters from the sea level. So to concentrate all of you, we have personally, I'm very much connected to the rainbow trout culture in the Trishuli area. So we have three private farm culture station associated with the local fish farmer in the Trishuli, which is very close to the Nuwakot. So now altogether in the country, main trout farms are in the Godavari, in the Lalitpur, Trishuli, in the Nuwakot, and in the Dhading, Rani Powa is the most center, and Satgunti in the Dhading, and Rupandehi, and also in Pokhara in the Gandaki area is the most important for the trout culture. Rainbow trout is a highly commercial sport and market fish. A normal adult rainbow trout weighs about 2 to 3 kg, while its maximum size, weight, and age are 120 centimeters in total length. It lives in upper and cold water section of the river and streams in the Trishuli area as well as in the Gandaki area, And as in case of other trout like the Sizothorax and other trout habitat, rainbow trout determine both their actual color and the shape. So rainbow is, it is the seven colored fish in the country. So in many countries, the albino form rainbow trout is cultured and is often but mistakenly called golden trout, which is not available in our country. This form is a popular ornamental, but in Nepal, it's a natural rainbow trout having the rainbow colored, the seven colored rainbow trout is only available. The rainbow trout culture in Thrissur is being practiced in water coming down from the glacier, whereas spring water is used in the Godavari station. So there are two different climatic conditions. In the first, in Thrissur, the water is coming from the raceways, and in the Godavari, the water is coming in the spring water, that is through the natural system. The area of the trout farm at Thrissur is around 2,000 square meter, whereas it is nearly 300 square meter in the Godavari area. The breeding of the rainbow trout was initiated around in the 1990, and the experiment on the rainbow trout cultivated started during that time in 1993. At present, the production technology has been well developed and verified in the farmers' raceways, and most of the people, they are practiced in both Godavari and Thrissur area to earn money with this business. And presently, it has been growing 10,000 to 20,000 fingerlings of rainbow trout each year in the area of 136 square kilometer. And the cost of the rainbow trout is now around in the Nepalese currency is 1,200 to 1,500 per kg. The total production of trout in Nepal is estimated around 17 metric ton in the old data, where the nowadays it is 42 metric ton in the capture form. So the trout needs, we are coming to the cultivation part. So trout need clean and cold water for its growth. Earthen ponds are not used, but they can also be used for the growing trout. If abundant, the round cold water is available, then earthen pond can be used. The concrete raceway is the common practice and of the different shape and size used normally for the trout culture. Circular tanks typically range from the 4 to 6 meter in diameter, but less suited to automated handling. It is difficult to the harvesting and have been used for the rare process in some different difficult areas. Generally, water supply equivalent to the stocking density is related for the trout culture is varied according to the station, culture station. In worst condition, when water flow are not regulated, negative correlation between stocking density and growth might occur. The stocking density can be increased up to 35 kg per meter water flow and sufficient. If the water supply is reliable, permanent, stable, and adequate, ponds can be constructed in parallel fashion to avoid contamination. But if water source is limited, then linear raceways for holding trout could be constructed. In Nepal, different types of both types of pond constructions in the slope area, in the linear process, and in the parallel fashion, both are available. However, it needs a filter chamber to clean the used and polluted water before sending to other raceways. Trout can be stocked in the, at the 50 to 100 feet per square meter, depending upon the water source quality and its flow, but the stocking density in government and the farmer's pond are present at the 50 feet per square meter. At this stocking rate of the marketable size, so 200 to 300 gram is the normal where we can harvest for the tourist purpose, and that reach up to the 14 to 16 month. However, fish need a graded timely to attain uniform and growth and avoid the cannibalism. So basically the problem in Nepal is that the mortality rate is high due to the lack of proper proper clean water. A specific growth rate decreases with the increasing size of the fish, and in general, if quality feed could be provided, the feed conversion ratio must be equal 2:1. So it requires about 2 kg of feed to produce 1 kg of water, 1 kg of trout. Trout farming is an ideal option for suitable use of water resources in Himalayan Kingdom region, especially in Nepal, because here both surface and underground waters are available for this purpose. In this region, where income generating and employment opportunities are the scarce, the trout farming could help to ensure employment and steady incomes. In addition to the production, trout farming could also ensure increased income and employment through angling tourism, restaurants, and related services. The concept of this technical paper we are sharing is the main to share the basic information about how much investment and day-to-day operation for the small-scale rainbow trout, and how a small farmer can earn money through this business. To satisfy the interest for the specific details, a glossary has been developed in the different way to easy to understand the easy and finding the different information. The combination of short explanation together with the illustration is the main aim to easy understand. And it is suggested that the farmers and all the consultant and the stakeholders, specialists who may help to avoid the unnecessary failure of the culture, the better production, the financial consequences, the cost imagination is most essential for this business. There are some photographic differences. So we can see in this photograph how the plane, the tanks are situated in this Himalayan region. And habitat is the main, the cold water, typically cold water, and the prefab, the fabric tank is the main important part for the various stages of the development. So now the clear water make the keen eyesight and crucial for efficient feeding of the trout. If the water is clean, the trout can see where is the food. The trout is carnivorous, so they need the clear and clean water. The dissolved oxygen should be highly concentrated and highly related for the respiration, smooth respiration of the fish. Clean water, besides the clear water, clean water is also that it is free from the harmful solid, harmful gaseous waste materials, and it produced the metabolic and respiration. And the food value, we can see that the different zooplanktons and different sources of the animal protein sources is essential for the rainbow trout production. So clean water must be there during the culture. Site selection, when selecting the production site, it is important to check the quality and quantity of the available water, as well as suitability of the site where the new fish farm is planned to be constructed. A rule of the thumb is that about 10 liters per second of the water source should be calculated for each 1 ton of rainbow trout produced. In general, both cold surface and underground waters are good for the trout farming. In the case of surface water, the daily fluctuation in the temperature may be affected, and during the summer and winter, the changes of water temperature may also affect the growth of the carp, and the better growth can be observed between the 5 to 15 degree. The temperature of spring and underground water has no daily fluctuation, and the differences between winter and summer are minimal if we will be careful. The quality of water should be consistent with those. The availability of the water may change considerably according to the season. So we can see that the how water can come from the different way. The flow of water should be that it makes the race, it makes the speed of the water from one pond to another pond. So it also gives the seasonal fluctuation and the quantity of the availability of water. So when determining the suitability of the site, the slope and soil quality should also be observed. And in the mountain area, the different step and slope level of the tank should be developed, pond should be developed, and that makes the availability of the water. So water supply and water quality is also the most important part for the culture of rainbow trout. The rainbow trout, the pH of water, rainbow trout tolerates unfavorable pH condition differently during the various different development phases of the fish. The optimal and acceptable ranges of pH of rearing water also differs. For developing embryos and fry, the range of optimal pH is narrow and varies between 6.5 and 8, but the range of acceptable pH is also narrow. For older fish, both the optimal and acceptable range of the pH are wider. There is a range of water temperature that is as minimum temperature is as best production for the growing seed, where the appetite of the rainbow trout is optimal. Outside of this range, at a lower and higher water temperature, fish lose appetite. Finally, at the low temperature is better. And feeding of the rainbow trout intensifies as the water temperature increases. However, this behavior continues only up to the 18 degree. Above this temperature, the appetite and the feeding intake by the fish sharply decreases and stops. It is important to be aware that there is an inverse correlation between the intensity of feeding and the utilization of consumed feed. Thus, the about 18 degrees Celsius rainbow trout are willing to feed very intensively, but the digestion of consumed feed will be less complete at this temperature. The water temperature where the different trout species make the best growth out of the consumed feed, it varies between 13 to 15 degrees Celsius. Dissolved oxygen in water ensures the respiration of the different aquatic plants and animals. Most frequently, the dissolved oxygen content of water is expressed in the milligram. The minimum oxygen content of the water depends on the actual water temperature. This is because the water can dissolve only a certain quantity of the oxygen which is determined by the partial pressure of the oxygen in the atmosphere. In the rainbow trout, at the higher temperature of the water, the dissolved oxygen content is lower, and it is vice versa. At the maximum oxygen content, the water is 100% saturated. The optimal and acceptable concentration of oxygen in water vary according to actual developmental stage of the fish. Water supply by gravity to fish farm and its rearing devices and structure is very important. This saves energy and consequently large amount in terms of production cost. The water supply to rearing devices can be done in two different ways. The rearing devices can be supplied either in parallel form or in series form. If the rearing tanks are connected to the water supply in series, the fresh water should be used first in tanks. Ponds of water, younger fish, from where water flows into the tanks, or ponds of older age groups of fish. Although arranging tanks in series is rather frequent, construction of new tanks should be prioritized parallel to the water supply. Especially in case of surface water, the construction of water reservoir at the highest point of the fish farm will facilitate easy and efficient water management. The elevated central water reservoir will serve as a buffer where the water also settles. The water from the reservoir can be channeled to the rearing devices and structures through open canals, pipes, or through a combination of both. So we can see this figure that the water is coming from the one source going to the another and another. In this way, the continue process is going on. Here I have seen all these, the same process in Nepal as well as in the United States. They are also doing the same process. So natural food is the most important part. The actual natural food of the rainbow trout depends on the age and size of the fish, on the size of the food item, on the habitat occupied. Rainbow trout are aggressive and greedy in feeding. They are opportunistic feeder that grab and eat almost anything. Terrestrial insects are also consumed when they fall into the water. These insects are adult beetles, ants, and the larvae of the Lepidoptera. Nowadays, regarding the feeding, when I went to the United States, I used the rainbow trout feed as an alternate of the animal protein in the form of the larvae of black soldier fly. So as the food measure, food is the basically based on the length and weight of the fish. So the size of the food is directly concerned to the size of the fish. So duration of the developmental stage, how this water temperature is determining factor of the fish production. This is because the body temperature of the embryo, fry, and developing of fish equalize their temperature and that water they are in. Along with the body temperature, the intensity of the metabolism also changes. So we can see that the egg is having the different stages, and the length of the egg, the weight of the egg varies, and what type of food should be given and how it goes to the different stages. So the total length of the development of embryo and the fry from the fertilization to the swim up to about 37 to 83 days at water temperature between 6 to 12 degrees. After starting external feeding, the actual length of the development of different age group depends not only on the temperature and oxygen content of water, but also on the quality and quantity of the consumed food. In determining the following figures that we have seen, it has been assumed that the trout is adequately fed with the commercial feed, which are readily and widely available in the countries in the different part of the world. So development of the fingerling from the fry takes 3 to 4.5 months. For the sake of clear understanding, simple calculation is related, and it depends on the how much food is supplied, and their growth is based on the supply of the food. The development of table size of fish from the fingerling takes 4 to 6 months. And for the sake of clear understanding, simple calculation is also, it is related to the how the beginning and how the end, how the fish reached to the 250 grams from the beginning. So growth of the large table from the 250 gram to 500 gram takes the further another 2.5 to 4 months. So in this way, the production option is having the different way, and we can make the how the plan, we have to develop the plan that from the egg to the table size or market size of fish, how much time is taken, and during the culture, during the production, we have to be careful that the mortality should be minimum. And it is because of the directly related to the supply of food and the quality of the water. So first eyed egg production, this production option is not recommended for those who are about to start trout farming. The necessary quantity of eyed egg can be purchased from the brood fish farm specialized on the production of high quality of eyed egg. The reason why it is recommended not to start with eyed egg production is that even the basic management of brood fish stock, a hatchery requires specialized skill and extensive practice, which can only be gained through the training. From the specialized brood fish farm, the eyed egg of all female stocks can also be purchased. Fry production, this option can be started either with the fertilized egg or with the purchase of the eyed egg. The fingerling production, this production has different options for practical reasons. So there are circumstances where the fry are too small to stock for the production facilities, or the farmers may need larger young fish. The fingerling production unit can be operated separately. Hatching tray, fiberglass, or polypropylene rearing trough and tanks, membrane tanks, concrete tanks, lined or underlined earth tanks are the production device of the fry, fingerlings, and other different table size of fish. Hatchling trays are the device of the incubation of eggs and sack fry. The bottom of the tray is sieve materials on which the eggs and sack fry rest. They receive fresh water through the sieve from under the tray as illustrated. Although the material shape and size of the hatching trays may vary, the quantity of eggs and the sack fry that can be incubated on them are very similar. A hatching tray about 0.2 square meter is needed for the incubation and hatching of around 10,000 rainbow trout eggs. So the hatching tray is the common practice everywhere in the world, and it is also in the Nepal. Fiberglass and the concrete tank also, the fiberglass and different size of small tanks can be used. The shallow thought can be used, the membrane tanks also used, and the basically the indoor tanks is used in different part of the country. And here we can see the different figure that the rectangular and square and circular tanks, it is very common. And this type of the tanks can be developed in different area while doing the rainbow trout culture. The typical shape of the concrete tank is this is very common tank, and this common tank, only that we have to be careful that how water is coming, and before introducing the water to the tank, the water should be treated, pre-treated. On many trout ponds, the production starts when eyed egg fry and fingerlings arrive from the another farm. So before the actual arrival of the eggs, all the rearing devices should be cleaned and disinfected. Trout are very sensitive to changes in water temperature, especially when it is from the cold to warm. The smaller the fish, the more sensitive they are to thermal shock in general. So to warm thermal shock is a very much particular. Therefore, it is important to raise or lower the temperature of the transport water slowly in steps, that is 0.5 degree minimum, in order to ensure the safe transporting. So here we are going to the now basic life cycle and the rearing system, and we can see this photograph that the female and female brood stock is having the 2 to 3 years brood stock is now. Injection is given, and after that the striping is there, and after striping, the fertilization, the mixing of the egg with the sperm. And after the fertilization, the hatchery is developed, and in the hatchery, we just give the time. We have to supply what type of food is supplied at what age of the trout at their larval stage or egg stage is more essential. Need eyed eggs in the tray, and we have to count that how much eggs are there. So trout can be bred after the attaining 2 years. In general, 3 to 4 years old single female can lead up to 3,000 to 3,500 eggs per kg. It is to know that in Nepal, that if we have 3,000 eggs, then the 1,000 eggs automatically die. Only we just get that only 2,000 eggs. So mortality is due to the different causes, and basically we are facing the pollution from the road. So however, breeding performance and quality eggs depends on the quality of water, feed, and other different management. So the brood fish should be fed at least 35% protein content diet at the rate of 2 to 3% of body weight once or twice daily. 2 years old adult rainbow trout are bred artificially once in a year during December to March, and the same group of brood can be used for coming years. The older brood generally lays higher number of eggs as per their body weight, and these broods also produce large eggs. The smaller eggs might have the low hatchability, centrally large eggs, and produce. The eggs are striped from the females, and the striped eggs are fertilized with the milk obtained from the males. Normally, one male can supply enough milk for the eggs of the two females. The fertilized eggs are incubated in incubation trays in incubators where clean and cold water should be supplied. The water used for incubation should contain the concentration of dissolved oxygen. The eggs used for incubation and hatching out within 20 to 30 days of interval, depending on the temperature of water. The nursing and newly hatched sac fry are called alevin, which is about 0.08 gram. And after the beginning, the alevin with the large yolk sac cannot swim well. These alevin are fed with the starter feed and which contains 35 to 40% crude protein. The feeding is generally performed at 2 hours interval in daytime and up to the 3 gram size. After the 3 gram size, fingerlings are fed 8 to 10% of body weight of the fish. Alternative to the starter feed from the nursing, frozen raw buffalo liver mixed with the starter feed has been proved to be one of the best starter diet with healthy and better growth compared to other diet fish meal. 30% mixed with the local feed, 30% earthworm mixed with the local feed, and 100% earthworm. So different way we have done. There are so many works has been completed successfully. So now this figure, we can see that this is our one of the station where we are doing these days the rainbow trout culture, and with the help of in association with the local farmer. And this is on the way of the Trishuli Highway. So how the pollution of the roadway also may affect the water, the contamination of water, and we are facing the problem in culture of the rainbow trout in very proper way. So we can see how the water is clean, and there are the variation of water. So before sending the water from one tank to other tank, the treatment, pre-treatment of the water is very essential, and we are very much careful. Even then, we are facing 50% mortality. Out of 3,000 eggs, only 1,500 to 2,000 eggs are survived, and we are getting. And the food is very, very costly in our country. So this is the one of the system of in the Godavari, and in the Godavari, they are the plain area, and the rainbow trout, the water is coming from the general resources, and they have their system of rearing. Now this figure, that this is one of the very just simple information regarding when I was in the University of Idaho, USA. So in the world's topmost center for the rainbow trout culture is the Hagerman Fish Culture Experiment Station at the University of Idaho. And during the 2019, I was there, and I spent more than 1 year here and did 2 to 3 experiments on the rainbow trout. So this is the field area. This is the culture station area. Their water is coming from the snow for rainfall. Raceway water is coming, and they have the Colorado River. And from the river bank of the river, they supply the water from one source, and the water goes out. So it is the continuous flow of the water. And average temperature of this pond is 12 to 15. Throughout the year. So they are rich. And from here, this full place throughout the United States, the rainbow trout in the large scale of the production is going on. So this is the internal indoor, the hatching house, and where we did the rearing as well as the culture and the feed trial. So we can see, so this is the egg of the different age group. And this is the culture station and other station. So we did so many experiments. So in summary, the trout farming has ultimately become a successful story in Nepal. And after more than a decade of the continuous and untiring efforts, the introduction of rainbow trout has opened a window of opportunity to enhance the commercial production of cold water fish species in the country, and has encouraged the people of the mountainous and hilly regions. A fully established trout culture industry could be one of the best means to reduce widespread poverty in highland areas of the country. Trout farming can play a greater role not only by generating income for farmers, but also by providing job opportunity to others involved in associated business activities such as processing and marketing. Further, in addition to increasing national fish production, exporting trout would help to earn foreign exchange. As per export fish, trout production could also help to enhance a country's ecotourism industry by providing fishing sports. So with this information, I thank you all. And I would like to stop the sharing. And very, very thankful that all of you heard very smoothly. And now I'm ready to share my experience, not only in Nepal, but very recently, just 4 months ago, during the corona panic, I just returned back from the United States, from the University of Idaho, after completed my experiment on the effects of black soldier fly larvae feed on the fish growth, on the growth of the rainbow trout. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Professor Lab. Dr. Bipul, you want to say something? If participants have some queries.
Now the session is open for the questionnaire, for the question, any query, any suggestions, all are requested to discuss anything with Dr. Lab sir. Please, please, now session is open. Yes.
कहाँ पे होगा कोई तो है वो आप बताएं कोई क्वेश्चन है तो
DCFR भीमताल से भी डॉक्टर रानन पांडे इज देयर विद अस यू वांट टू से समथिंग डॉक्टर पांडे
Dr. Narayan, I want to give some information. India, who we started trout culture 1899 when it was brought to India by Colonel Mitchell. But successfully in 1905-96, we started ground trout in India, and 1910-11, rainbow trout was successfully done in India, and then in somewhere 57-60, brook trout was introduced and successful. So one talked about rainbow trout only. The incubation period is around 60 to 70 days when the temperature is between 8 and 12 degrees centigrade. Incubation period is higher, it will lower in rainbow trout, while brook trout it is 110 to 115 degrees. And growth, the survival from green eggs to fry is good. But between fry and ear fingerling, the survival is only 25%. And up to 1968, what was Mitchell doing, that was being followed in the country. But after 1968, when cold water fisheries was started under the leadership of Dr. Sehgal, there was enhancing of the production, but not by some technical or scientific, only by using some clean methods. Or scientific methods like picking up the eggs, dead eggs every day, like giving individual water supply to every tank, then the feed, outside feed formation, then how to manage it. Only managerial aspects were taken, and the growth was between green X to prior, it was around 85%, 80 to 85%. Then prior, it was only 25%. Then adult fish was adapted up to 1.5 years when table fish was being poured. So even in veganity, it was around 1,000 to 1,200 in brown trout. Rainbow, it was 12 to 13. But with management practice, it was enhanced by 200-300 eggs per kg baby weight. Like that, only scientific methods were adopted, not as a genetically or this thing, only in certain countries, but selective breeding or selective culture is being done. The fast-growing fish is used, there the enhancement is very high. And then the size of feed is as per the opening mouth or the size of fish. So in the early stages, the young ones don't take artificial feed directly. You have to start with 10% artificial feed, 90% nature. Then slowly you have to shift fully to artificial feeds. There are so many points which are very much advanced. And now in NRC cold water fishery, a lot of work has been done on this thing to enhance the things. And temperature is the most important. Once it's not crossed 20 degrees centigrade, rainbow trout will not survive.
So what I learned here is the as low the temperature, the better growth can be heard. But the temperature is not only the major factor as compared to the American technology, American how they are doing. Our concentration should be more towards the cleaning of the water. So before introducing the water, the waters must be treated as clean as the best water will be given. The growth will be perfect. So that is the most important part. Temperature as well as the cleanliness of the water. That is the main thing.
Latest form in India, one is Patlikul fish form in Himachal Pradesh, the other is Kukarna fish form. In both, in Kukarna fish form, the water comes from spring, and which is already very clean, and then simple filters are being kept. Otherwise, minerals are there, everything is there, but only in certain cases when, around 1971, when the structure of this, our springs was changed to pH 6.0, that becomes different. But only in general cases, spring water or there is seepage water from the high lakes is coming here. That's best for this thing. But in Kulu fish farm, there the water comes from the Manila, this cities. From it crosses city, where there's a fecal matter comes into that. In that case, there's a mortality.
Yeah.
Thank you, Dr. Langer. The moot point is that it needs a highly oxygenated crystal clear water. Cool, yeah. That's the moot point. Okay. Any other? Dr. Pandey?
Yeah. Good evening, sir. Dr. Narayan, this is Dr. N. Pandey. I am principal scientist at Directorate of Cold Water Fisheries Research, Bhimtal. This is ICR Institute. And I appreciate and I thankful for your good talk and very informative to students at College of Fisheries, Pantnagar. So just I would like to know the production cost for this rainbow trout is in higher side due to the means costly feed. And this higher cost of feed is due to this fish meal. Particularly in India, this fish meal is, the price of fish meal is in higher side. So just to reduce the feeding cost or to reduce this production cost, is there any option or alternative of this fish meal? How we can reduce the production cost in rainbow trout farming, please?
Thank you, sir. This is the global question, not only related to us, but this is a question related to throughout the world that everyone is facing the same. But when I saw in the University of Idaho, in the Dr. Ron Hardy's lab in the rainbow trout, there is one guy, the scientist known as Kane Overtop. So Dr. Kane Overtop is since more than decades, he is busy in giving the vegetarian diet to the rainbow trout. Remember my word. Rainbow trout in United States, in that area where in the, I just show you the Hagerman Research Center at University of Idaho, they are on the trial with the aids of the USDA project. They are supplying, instead of animal protein, they are giving the plant protein to the rainbow trout, and they are in process of thinking that in one day there will be success. But when I did my research, I learned that instead of fish meal, which is very costly to the farmer to buy the fish meal, so we have to alternate the fish meal like the earthworm meal, insect meal, or which one is the alternate of the animal protein having the low cost price. That gives the information. So black soldier fly, if you use black soldier fly larvae in your fish, in your diet to supplement the fish meal, to replace the fish meal, then definitely it will be the cheaper food for the rainbow trout culture.
Thank you very much, sir.
Mention of the participants and Dr. Pandey especially, that Professor Lav is having his second lecture on nutrition and feed requirement of rainbow trout at 30th December.
Yes, sir.
I hope we all will participate in that.
Yes, sir. Sure, sir.
Okay.
I hand over
to Dr. Vipul.
Sir, one question is also there from Tamanna Jargar. It's asking that how much time, just growth related, how much time it will take to gain 250 gram weight. That is temperature.
So it depends on the what type of climate is given. So if the climate is not sufficient, it may take 2 to 3 years. But if the climate is sufficient, then 3 to 4 months is also, 6 months is a standard if the water and the everything is okay. But in our country, as especially in Nepal and the neighbor country, we are poor in providing the sufficient climate to the product, to the culture of the rainbow trout. So that's why it varies. The growth rate varies according to the site, according to the location. It depends. Location and temperature.
No other question? Then I must say thank you very much, sir, for your nice presentation, interaction, content, and everything, sir. Thank you very much for sparing time for us. We are very much thankful to you for being with us and delivered such a nice informative lecture, which will no doubt that will be very much informative and good for our students as well as all the stakeholders and all. So thank you very much, sir. Thank you from the college and NAHEP team. Thanks to our respected dean, sir, also, who is very much keen in organizing in such type of lecture. And he took personal care and the pain to organize such a good lecture. Thank you very much, sir. Thanks to all the guests. I am seeing maybe some I could not recognize. Dr. R.K. Langar, sir, Dr. N.N. Pandey, Dr. Deepak Agarwal from PNFU Chennai, Dr. Madhuri Sharma, and so many others are there. So thanks for joining us and encouraging us. Thank you. Thanks to the all the faculty members also, those have joined and contributed. And especially to all the participants, all the students, those have joined the program. Thank you one and all. Thank you very much. Sir, you want to say something? Please, sir.